Hello, my dear students. Today we will be discussing about another important technique to solve different kind of problems. The technique is called dynamic programming. We have already studied about another different techniques to solve problems like greedy technique, divide and conquer technique, etc. So today we will be discussing about how we are using dynamic programming concepts to solve the different kind of problems. So what is dynamic programming? See, all these problems like knapsack problem, shortest path problem can be solved by using greedy technique. How we are solving is like we will make optimal decisions at a time, one at a time. But in many cases, it is not possible to find a solution by finding only one solution at a time. So we will be making a sequence of decisions and we will take the best of the decisions from it to find the solution. For example, if we want to find the shortest path from vertex I to vertex J, suppose AI are the set of vertices which is adjacent from vertex I. In order to find the shortest path, which is the second vertex to pick from that set of vertices, that we won't be able to find out if you are taking one decision at a time. So we will be finding all the possible solutions from this and we will pick the best from this. So the principle of optimality will be used to reduce the decision sequences. We will be finding n number of decision sequences and in that we will be finding the best solution for this by using the principle of optimality. Principle of optimality is nothing but whatever be the initial state and decisions are, the remaining decisions must contribute to an optimal decision sequence. That is, in the greedy technique, we are using only one decision sequence. We will move forward. We will take the best solution at a time. That point of time, what will be the best solution that we will take? And in dynamic programming, we will check for all the possible solutions and we will find out the best solution in this. An algorithm which uses the dynamic programming is the Walsh's algorithm, which is used to find the transitive closure. We all know what is transitive closure. What is transitive closure? If A of B is equal to 1 and if B of D is equal to 1, then we can say that A of D is equal to 1. That's the transitive closure. So how we are applying the transitive closure concept in algorithm is, we want to find the path in all possible path in the algorithm or in the graph. So for example, here it is given one graph and this is the adjacency matrix of this particular graph and this is the transitive closure of this particular graph. For example, here 2 to 1 is path is there and 1 to 3, so it will be represented by 2 to 3, the directed edge. See, this is a 2 to 3 directed edge. Now here if you see 2 to 4 and 4 to 2 path is there. That means 2 to 2 path will be there. That is the thing that is shown here. So this is a transitive closure. Now we will discuss how we are using the transitive closure for Walsh's algorithm. See, the idea is the path exists between two vertices if and only if. What are the conditions? There should be an edge from I to A, J. That is a directed path. And there is a path from I to J going through vertex 1. That is, only one vertex will be considered at a time. Then we will find out the path. Then we will find out 1 or 2 vertices. Then we will find out 1, 2, or 3 vertices. Like that, we will go till we find all the path. So how we are going to find out this is, on the kth iteration, this is the formula for this one. On the kth iteration, we will check if the path exists between two vertices I and J. We will make use of the intermediate vertices to find the path. For example, here R K of minus 1 IJ. R represents adjacency matrix. Okay. And R of I, if it has R of IJ or R of IK and KJ. Here K is the intermediate vertex. That means if there is a path from I to J directly, or there should be a path from I to K and K to J, then we can say that R of IJ is equal to 1. So we will understand better if you are going to a problem. See, this is an example of a graph, of a directed graph, and this is adjacency matrix. When we are applying all these criteria for finding the Walsh's algorithm, we will be getting this transitive closure like this. See, here, one example I will tell you. Here, A to B, B to D path is there, right? But when we write the adjacency matrix, here there is no path from A to D. See, A to D is equal to 0 because it is represents that there is no directed edge. But what we are going to find out here is if there is a path from any vertex to any other vertex, though it is directed edge or though it is undirected edge, in the sense not the direct path, whether it is by including the intermediate vertices, that also we will include. See, here A to D is equal to 1. Why? Because A to B, B to D path is there. That means we can go to D from A. That means that it is 1. We will find out better in this. See, how we are finding out this, as I've told you before, this is a root 2 rules. From I to j, if path is there, it remains 1. If I to j and j to, if I to k and k to j path is there, then I of j is equal to 1, that we will mention here. See, here this is an example. We will be writing the matrices. See here, these two values are 1. That means I k is 1 and k j is 1. That means that you can write ij is equal to 1. That is the thing which is represented here. Ij is equal to 1. That means ik is equal to 1 and kj is equal to 1. We can write ij is equal to 1. See, this is an example for the graph. This is r of 0, r of 1, r of 2. R of 0 means there is no intermediate vertex. R of 1 means 1 intermediate vertex. 2 means 2 intermediate vertex. 3 means 3 intermediate vertex. This is the thing we are going to find out here. In order to find out this one, we will take the first column and first row. We will check which are the values 1 here. See here, DA is equal to 1 and AB is equal to 1. DA is 1 and AB is equal to 1. That means we can write DB is equal to 1. That is the thing which is shown here in the bold letter. So DB is equal to 1. Then this is about only these two values are 1 here. So we will move forward to the next one, that is R of 1. R of 1, we will use the second row and second column. See, in this second row, when we find out the value, here B, D is equal to 1, A, B is equal to 1 and D, B is equal to 1. That means D, B is equal to 1 and B, D is equal to 1. D, B is equal to 1 and D, B is equal to 1 and B, D is equal to 1, then you can write as D, D is equal to 1. This is the thing which is represented here, D is equal to 1. Same way you can write A, B is equal to 1 and B, D is equal to 1. That means you can write A, D is equal to 1. That is the thing which is showed here. Like this one, so this is all about the combinations you are getting here. We will move forward in the next one. Next one, we will write third row and third column. Only one value here, so we will not write anything, we will not change anything. Next, we will move forward R of 3, that is fourth row and fourth column. Here you will get so many combinations. After solving all these combinations, you will get all these changed values here. So at the end, R of 4, that means four vertices are there, R of 4. R of 4, what is the value which we are getting at the matrix at the end? That is the transitive closure of this particular graph. So that means that in this graph there is path from A to A, A to B, A to C, A to D, B to A, B to B, B to C, B to D. Since C is not having any outgoing edges here, when we look into the graph itself, we will find out. See, this is 0. Hope you understand. This is algorithm for this, the same algorithm that I have discussed before. See, R of ij is equal to R of ij or R of ik into R of ik and R of kj. So this is about the Marshall's algorithm. Hope you have understood the algorithm here. If you have any doubts, you can ask me directly. So that's all about today. Thank you.